New York City. On a street in the East 40s, there's an ordinary tailor shop. Or is it ordinary? We entered through the agent's entrance, and we are now in UNCLE headquarters. That's the United Network Command for Law and Enforcement. UNCLE is an organization consisting of agents of all nationalities. It's involved in maintaining political and legal order anywhere in the world.
My name is Napoleon Soto. I'm an enforcement agent in Section 2 here. That's operations and enforcement.
I am Ilya Kuryakin. I am also an enforcement agent. Like my friend Napoleon, I go and I do whatever I am told to by our chief.
Huh? Oh, yes. Alexander Waverly, number one, Section 1. In charge of this, our New York headquarters. It's from here that I send these young men on their various missions.
Craig Hodge, Section 8. Tonight's mission, China.
We're in Beijing, the capital of China, and Beijing is a modern city. It's a spacious city, a clean city, and a city where the traffic, considering the population, is relatively light. There are some jokes going around about China. You see, China sometimes uses as much as half of the world's steel. It's in a building boom. And maybe half of the world's construction cranes are in operation in China. So the joke is, what is the national bird of China? In fact, of course, China doesn't have a national bird. But the answer to the question actually tells you quite a bit about China and the humor of the thing. The correct answer to the question, what is the national bird of China, is the crane, the construction crane. But of course, we're not here to see the modern city, not really. We're here primarily to see old China. This is Beijing, but this is the Summer Palace. Beijing has been the capital of China for only a few hundred years, and by Chinese standards, this is a relatively new city. The Dowager Empress was building this garden, but she didn't really have the money that she was looking for. Now, it happens that the Chinese Parliament had voted money for the Chinese Navy's improvement, and had that money been spent that way, China might well have been better able to defend itself. But as it was, the Empress Cixi took the money and spent it on the Summer Palace. And in recognition of the fact that the money is a funding violation, she built this marble barge as part of the Summer Palace. It simply recognizes the fact that the money was supposed to go to the Chinese Navy, and this is what it bought instead. But so much for the early 1900s. We're going to be going back further in time. Indeed, over several different locations, much further in time. And we're headed south, to South and Southwest China, Hunan and Sichuan provinces. In the province of Sichuan, north of the city of Chengdu, there's an archaeological site. The site is the site of the capital of the Kingdom of Shu. And at one time, not too long ago, in fact, before this archaeological dig started, there was some speculation that the Kingdom of Shu was entirely mythological. You see, it dates back to about the time of the Siege of Troy, or King David of Israel. So it was quite old indeed. And what they found at this archaeological site was some absolutely fantastic bronzes. And the designs are extremely interesting. I don't think I've ever seen anything just exactly like it. These bronzes that you're looking at now have gold face masks on them. The site is called San Shuing Dui, which apparently means something like three star piles or mounds. And those mounds turn out to have been the southern wall of the city. The city was breached in several places, and so the wall turned out to be piles of dirt instead of a linear formation. This particular site was developed in 1986. The site itself, actually, the artifacts can date back to 2700 BC, although the bronzes, of course, are much more recent. This is just a sampling of what I saw. The first thing that I want to bring your attention to are, well, they're basically older things. This happens to be a wine pitcher on a tripod. And following that, there's a series of bird's heads. Now, these bird's heads are going to be repeated pretty often, so they must have some kind of cultural or religious significance. I'm not sure what kind of birds these are supposed to be. It's entirely something that I really don't understand. But this is a jade spearhead. Now, see how finely the jade is worked, how smooth it is. This is a collection of jade beads, probably for bracelets or necklaces or something. And these are tiger's teeth that apparently are also being used for decoration. This is a very different world than what you think of for most of China. This is an elephant tusk. Obviously, they had tigers and elephants in the neighborhood. This next are spindle whorls. This is for making wool yarn. The next one is also a jade artifact. Now look how they've cut it. They've cut it perfectly round and perfectly smooth. This one is a little bit bigger, but also essentially the same. And this next one is absolutely monstrous. It's huge. It's about a yard across. These next are some small amber beads that have been drilled out and shaped. They're absolutely exquisite. And this is something very interesting. It's a ceremonial blade of some kind, and we're going to be seeing that again later. These are also jade points, probably also ceremonial. This is gold. Gold leaf is something that they were really, really into. This is a face mask made out of gold foil. This is a walking stick, or what's left of it. It's the gold foil that used to surround it. And this is a tree, a bronze tree. It's about 12, 13 feet tall, something like that. But it's not exactly like what you would think of as an ordinary tree. And instead of having leaves and limbs on it, it's got all kinds of decorations. This one also is fairly similar. These trees are mythological trees. Trees like, to think of our own mythology, the tree of life, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, the tree of heaven. These have religious artifacts on them. And one of the religious symbols that's often on this tree is a bird. And also those blades, those ceremonial blades that I mentioned earlier. What I really want to focus on now is the birds that happen to be in the tree. They repeat themselves quite often, but they're very interesting in their design. Take a closer look at them and see what they remind you of in terms of their style. They've got that big beaked, hooked beak. It looks like it could be some kind of a raptor, maybe. This bird has a very interesting little headdress on it. And always they have that hooked beak. These next designs that we're going to be looking at are not Chinese. They're Aztec and Mayan, and they strike me as being quite similar to what we found in this particular archaeological site. And on this bird, we find red ochre, and that suggests that these figures were probably painted. These are some of the face masks that we saw, and there are huge numbers of them, and this one is absolutely huge itself. This one is really bizarre. It's got bug eyes on it. That reminds me an awful lot of some of the statues in Sumerian art. The eyes are extraordinarily large sometimes in the votive offerings there. And these are some smaller, apparently they're symbolizing the worshipers, and they're probably left behind as an offering or as an indication that the person is continuously worshiping the gods. But of course, the ones that are most fantastic are the three that I started out with. Notice that the back is also done, and the back of the mask has a pigtail on it. Outside, we see a sacrifice altar, and on it there's an absolutely huge statue, a bronze statue. This next photograph is a drawing of that sacrificial altar that we just saw the replica of. And what it looks like to me, with the ramps and the steps and everything in it, is it looks to me very much like it's Mayan, possibly even Aztec or something, but Mayan for sure, at least early Mayan. And it's so striking, along with the styles of the birds and everything, I can't help but think that there might be some connection. Now, this traditional-looking village is in Hunan, and its name is Fenghuang, although it's more commonly called Phoenix City in an English translation. It's obviously a river city, and the river plays an important part in this city's history and in the construction that you see along the river. One of the things that you'll notice is that they have a series of rapids, dams, if you will, And there are also a number of bridges over the river as well. It's apparently laundry day. And you can see a number of boats out there. Now, those boats are primarily for tourists, because this town now is primarily a tourist town. That is, a lot of what you see has been preserved primarily for tourists. And I'm not talking about Western tourists. I'm talking mostly about Asian tourists. Much of the nightlife in this city has been taken over by bars, and it's fairly commercial now. It may not appear that way to you, but at night this place is going to light up. Like I said, it's apparently wash day, and you can see people out on the side of the river doing their laundry. I haven't the foggiest idea how much of this is for tourist consumption and how much of this is real. One of the ways to get across the river is by stepping on these little concrete pillars and just kind of walking your way across. Incidentally, the ladies that you saw there were in Tuja outfits. There are two minorities here in town. The Tuja, which are not in the majority in this particular area, and the Miao people. So the birds that you're going to see coming up in just a second are cormorants. They're used for fishing, or they were used for fishing. A ring would be placed around their neck so that they couldn't swallow, and the birds would be sent over the side to look for fish. They'd grab a fish, bring it on up, the fisherman would take it away from them, and every once in a while, of course, he'd let the cormorants keep them. These birds today are just for tourists. They're not working birds. They don't represent any actual fishing. Oh, and if the birds don't get a fair portion of the catch, they'll go on strike. Last July, there was a considerable amount of flooding in this area, and I'm a little bit surprised that the area has recovered quite so well. You can see a substantial portion of where we were standing is underwater in July. Plus, a number of those houses that are at the sides of the river, the lower levels of those got flooded.
Heavy rain has triggered floods in central China's Sunan province, hitting the famous ancient town of Fenghuang. Waters in the nearby Tuajiang River rose by almost 1 meter above warning level, causing severe flooding and power outages. Over 50,000 residents and tourists were evacuated from the town, and several scenic spots were closed. Other counties in Hunan have also been affected.
For many purposes, this city marks the end of imperial rule. Points south of this were generally not under control of Beijing. In fact, not very far from here, there was a great wall built, a southern great wall, not nearly as big as the one near Beijing, of course, or sophisticated, but one to keep the empire secure, but in the south this time. In fact, not too far from here, there's a valley called Hundred Battle Valley. And that is where the Tuja armies held off the imperial forces for a while. The vast majority of the Chinese population are ethnically Han Chinese, but the Chinese in this particular area are generally not. They're one of the several minorities. In fact, there are about 55 minorities. It was these minorities that were able to keep the imperial forces from penetrating too deeply into the mountains, which was their homeland, which they were defending. Here's something that I often run across. It's a professional photographer, and she's trying to take some pictures of a model. It's in Tuja dress, and she's using the city as a backdrop. I don't have any idea exactly why she's taking these particular pictures, but it's clear she's professional. We're moving a little bit north of Phoenix City now to an area known as Zhangjiajie. It's a very scenic area, but it's still in the province of Hunan. This is also basically a Tuja area. And in fact, our guide, Lisa, was half Tuja and identifies with them. Lisa told us quite a bit about her minority group. But one of the things that she mentioned was that a young girl who's not married can be identified by looking at her shoes. The shoes will have flowers on them. A man, on the other hand, is likely to have a ring in his ear. When such a boy meets such a girl and decides that he'd like to marry her, he's likely to take his foot and touch hers, and then they go to a secluded place. When they're in that secluded place, they will sing to each other the mountain song. And in that song, they'll tell each other about their ages, their family background, and so forth. Among the Tuja minority, the mountain people, the normal greeting isn't ni hao as it is in most Chinese places. Instead, it's yu hui, and this is shouted apparently from mountaintop to mountaintop. And our guide tells us that if we use that greeting instead of the ni hao, the merchant may give us a better deal if he's Tuja. One of the really big attractions in this area is the Fairy Fox Show. It's a musical that's put on every night. And while the plot is not terribly engaging, The staging and the music is particularly good. You can't buy this on DVD, I've discovered, and you can't see it any place other than this location where they show it every night.
Thank you. When you think of China, just exactly what is it that you think about? Well, among other things, you may think about landscapes. You see, Chinese paintings have a tendency to have landscapes in them that are entirely unrealistic. No place on earth ought to have land formations like that. And yet, in South China, where we're going, they do. Most of these are in the area around Guilin, on the Li River. And the fact is that these mountains are caused mostly by the fact that they're very weathered limestone. And some of them have very peculiar shapes indeed.
This is a map of the provinces of China, but instead of the name of the province, this particular map happens to have the name of the country that has essentially the same population as that province. In this case, we're going to Hunan. Hunan has roughly the same population of the country of France. There are several different ways that you can get up into the mountains. We're going to be taking the cable car. It runs for over 5 miles, and it's widely said to be the longest cable car in the world. This ride happens to start actually in town. The town is Zhangzheji. The road below us is said to have 99 turns in it. It leads up to a slightly different location in the mountains where Tiananmen Cave is located. It's not really a cave, it's more like a natural bridge, but we'll be seeing it later. The peaks in this mountain range generally run from 3,000 to 4,000 feet in elevation. Thank you. When you get to the top, there are sheer 1,000-foot drops everywhere that you look. The lady with the flag is Lisa, our guide. Our first objective at the top is what they call the Walk of Faith. They call it that because there's about a 60-yard stretch, about 200-foot stretch of the sidewalk there that is built into the side of a cliff, and that sidewalk is made out of glass. The result is you can see the sheer drop right below your feet. That house in the middle is basically where the that glass sidewalk begins, and you can see it there slightly to the right of the house. That's the sheer drop. Now, this is very much like what the American Indians did over the Grand Canyon. It's the same sort of structure for as far as I can tell. And frankly, if walking on this doesn't scare the bejesus out of you, I haven't the foggiest idea what's wrong with you. They hand out those little red booties to put over your shoes so that you don't scratch the glass. Now, this really tests your faith in human engineering. Well, the end is near, but this next scene is more like what I came up here to see. Unfortunately, the weather here was too good while I was there. Fog would have helped this one considerably, because when there's fog at the base of those pinnacles, and there's someplace between 3,000 and 4,000 of them in this area, depending on how you count them, it is entirely possible that those pinnacles look like they're floating on air. And that inspired some movie makers, in particular the folks that made Avatar. On the planet Pandora, there is a landscape that was largely inspired by these pinnacles. The Chinese were so enthused about the movie that they changed the names of some of the mountains in this area. Some of the areas are actually named after things that are supposed to be in Pandora. Pandora is a planet, and in that on that planet, they're supposed to have some topography, which is very, very similar to a combination of this and what you can find in Venezuela. In the interior of Venezuela, there's a series of plateaus called tepuis, and those tepuis are where Sir Arthur Conan Doyle had his lost world, complete with dinosaurs and such.
We're not allowed to run night ops. Colonel's orders.
The cartoon Kung Fu Panda also uses this same terrain as a background for some of its action. So these mountains have inspired a lot of artistic activity. Some of it, of course, the original Chinese painters, but in addition to that, the modern movie makers as well. But there's one more surprise that the Chinese have for you. There's an elevator going to the top of the mountains. You can take it up or down, of course, and either way, it's about 1,000 feet. So how did this place get to look the way that it does? Well, the answer is primarily water. Water withered away the limestone. So why doesn't all limestone formations look like this today? Well, the answer may very well be glaciers. This area never had them, never had the glaciers smoothing out the terrain like they do in most places. We're in what in China passes for the Grand Canyon. It's not as large as our Grand Canyon, but it is similar in many ways. It was cut by water, although it's a much smaller stream, and the depth of the cut isn't nearly as much. Nevertheless, it gives you a fair idea of what it was that weathered out that limestone into those formations. This is another view of that little river, but in this particular case, I've gone to extraordinary lengths to apply a certain amount of technology to see if I can get a different view. How do you think I did that? In this case, I used a quadcopter, a remote control aircraft, with a camera attached to the bottom of it. We're going back down the mountain now. On cable car again, and the view going down is every bit as good as it was going up. There's that serpentine road again. That goes up to a different part of the mountain range. It goes up to Tenement Cave, as I said before. And that is our next objective. So we're going to be taking a bus up to the cave. Now remember this cable car system and the serpentine road because we're going to be coming back to them. Now, this is the cave, and you can see that it's much less a cave than it is a natural bridge. In fact, I like to think of it as a donut, and in a few minutes, I think you'll see why. To save you a little time, we'll be going up a little bit faster than I did. There we are at the base of the cave. And you can see that there's a very long stairway that goes up to the top of the cave. That stairway has 999 steps in it. Apparently, the contract read that there had to be less than 1,000 steps. That reminds me of a cartoon that I once saw.
Ah, my old enemy. Stairs.
Carrying me those last few flights. Okay.
Since the early days of flight, airplane pilots have wanted to go through very narrow, very small places. That's partly where the term barnstorming came about. And the pilots have decided that Tiananmen Cave is a great place to do barnstorming. As a matter of fact, as many as four jets have gone through that cave at the same time. Now, they weren't going through wingtip to wingtip, but they were going through one right after the other. These are mostly Russian fighter jets, but there are also other kinds of aircraft that go through.
This aircraft is a simple one-propeller job. Apparently, doing aerobatics as you're going through the donut is not a big problem. In fact, it looks like just about any number of aircraft could pass through the donut hole without too much trouble, as long as they're following one right after the other.
The formation teams are the last to thunder through.
In addition to the other aircraft that go through the Tiananmen Cave, the natural bridge, there is also a lot of activity by guys wearing flying squirrel outfits. Now, I have heard about guys flying in flying squirrel outfits. I heard about a decade ago or so about somebody flying from England over to France across the Dover. And this is the first time, though, that I have actually seen videotape of people doing that kind of flying. And of course, one of the things that they're going to be interested in doing is flying around those gondolas. And another thing that they're going to be interested in doing is flying through the cave, through the natural bridge, just like the airplanes do.
I could always imagine how you could fly with an outfit like that, but I was always wondering how you would land. This at least answers that question. This guy is jumping with several different kinds of cameras. They're all the same maker, though. They're Hero GoPros. He's got one on his helmet and one on his chest, and so he's being able to pick up a fairly wide variety of angles. Another thing that's important about that GoPro from my standpoint is that it's the same kind of camera that I used on my quadcopter. It's very versatile, rugged, and relatively cheap if something happens to it. Now, you have no trouble telling where these people are at, because among other things, you've got that serpentine road down below you, and off to the right, there was Tenement Cave. Another thing that you can tell is that they're flying near the cable cars. Indeed, they're flying too near the cable cars. Now, this is apparently the secret ingredient that makes those flying squirrel outfits work. Now that's too close to those cable cars. You can always tell a happy flying squirrel because he's got bugs on his teeth. You know there's no reverse on this thing, so he's got to have it lined up just perfectly in order to be able to make this. Otherwise, he'll smash against the walls of the cave.
So now, how did those flying squirrels get those good pictures? Well, the way that they did it was with this. This little camera is called a Hero 2, and you can find people using it on Discovery Channel, Animal Planet, National Geographic. Sometimes they connect it to helmets, parts of machinery, long poles, things like that, anything that well, this camera's relatively cheap, so if something happens to it, it's no big deal. In addition to that, you can make this thing waterproof. It comes with its own waterproof case. All you got to do is stick it into the case like this, and there it goes. The control buttons are now on the outside of the waterproof case, and even if you're in scuba gear, you can operate this, or you can attach it to yourself. You can attach it to your helmet or a headband or to a wristband or something else. But nonetheless, this is what's taking those pictures. And it's extremely wide angle, which is why it doesn't have to be aimed. The fact of the matter is, the person that's shooting this video doesn't have to see what he's doing in order to probably get it, because it takes a look at almost everything. It's practically a fisheye is what it is. In this area, there's over 3,000 of those quartzite sandstone pillars and some 40 caves or so. In addition, there are about 3,000 different kinds of plants. 600 of them happen to be woody plants of one kind or another. In addition to that, there are a number of animals that are about to go extinct, including the giant salamander, the Chinese water deer, leopards, clouded leopards, Asiatic dogs, and others. This particular area has a very wide variety of vegetation. As a matter of fact, it has more different kinds of trees in this area of China than there are in all of Europe. One tree in particular is very, very interesting. It used to be that the Dawn Redwood was only known from fossils, and it was believed to be entirely extinct. But in 1943, it was discovered. There was a grove of them back here amongst these pinnacles. The Dawn Redwood has got that bald cypress sort of look about it, shaggy bark, small leaves, things like that. Now, it's pretty widely grown, but at one time, you could only find it here in South China. And even today, in the wild, this is about the only place that you can find it. And here it is, the Dawn Redwood. Now, in addition to there being interesting plants in this area, there are a number of interesting animals. One of them is the Chinese water deer. Now, the Chinese water deer at a distance looks like Bambi, but when you get up close, this isn't Bambi. This is a saber-toothed deer, or a Dracula deer. It's got huge tusks coming down that look like fangs. Now, I've never heard of a person being attacked by a Chinese water deer. The deer are quite small. But I have heard of dogs being attacked by them. Those fangs can be used quite effectively in the deer's defense if it chooses to do so.
The clouded leopard is a relatively small cat, only about 50 pounds or so. But even the locals never see it back up here in these mountains. It's extremely elusive. All leopards are, but this one is extremely difficult to find. And you're not going to find it, but you can know that it's there. The reason is because its footprints are found every once in a while. Incidentally, for the size of cat, it has the longest canines of any cat. Another animal that is in this area but almost impossible to see is the muddy dragon.
There are only two places in the world where you can find true alligators. One is in the southern part of the United States, and the other is in the southern part of China, this part of China. Now, One of the things that makes an alligator different from a crocodile is that alligators are able to survive freezing temperatures. What they do is they go down under the surface of the water, they dig a burrow into the bank, and then go up until they're above the water level, and then they make their hole. And they sleep in that while the weather is quite cold. And so alligators can take temperatures that crocodiles simply can't. Now, the alligators in China are getting to be quite rare. There's only a few hundred of them. And the reason for that is because they're edible. This area, China, has giant salamanders. Now, giant salamanders are the largest amphibians in the world. And they were first known from their skeleton. In 1726, Johann Jakob Schweitzer, a Swiss physician, found the first one. He was a bit confused, however. You see, the salamander has a hand very much like the hand that a person would have. And he got confused, and he thought this salamander was a pre-Diluvian person. And so he named it the man who was the witness of the world pre-deluge, in Latin, of course. He was shortly proven to be wrong. And there are very large skeletons, very ancient skeletons, of these giant salamanders. The largest giant skeleton was found down in Australia. It was about 16 feet long. You see, back in the days of the dinosaurs, and before, much before actually, giant salamanders sort of played the role of the crocodile. They have a very powerful bite even today. And there are stories, at least among the Japanese, where they also have giant salamanders that are a little bit smaller than the Chinese giant salamander, that suggest that perhaps these giant salamanders have eaten children, or killed them at least, sometime in the past. The salamander itself generally grows out to be about 6 feet. Incidentally, that's Dr. Brady Barr. He works for National Geographic. And the one that he has is a Japanese salamander, the one that's slightly smaller than the Chinese. In 1983, in this area of Hunan, there was discovered a salamander, and this has not been verified, but it was reported to be about 10 feet long. That's much larger than any verified size. Maximum verified size is only 6 feet. Nevertheless, you can imagine that if they got to be about 10 feet long or so, yes, they probably could eat small children without any trouble.
The largest amphibian in the world, reaching up to 6 feet, is the Chinese giant salamander, also making it the largest salamander in the world. You will find this slimy-skinned monster living in the muddy, dark rock crevices along the banks of mountain streams and lakes in China and Taiwan. It has a large head with small eyes and dark, wrinkly skin that is lined with sensory nodes that make it capable of sensing the slightest vibrations around them. The average adult salamander weighs about 55 to 65 pounds and is almost 4 feet in length. Because of its strange vocalizations, bearing a striking resemblance to that of a human child crying, it is known in the Chinese language as infant fish. It is generally active at night, feeding on fish, smaller salamanders, worms, and a variety of insects. Reproduction occurs from late August to September. Hundreds of individual salamanders congregate at nest sites, where males often die, aggressively guarding their breeding cavities. The female will lay between 400 and 500 eggs that are held together like a string of beads. The eggs hatch approximately 12 to 15 weeks later in the early spring, with larvae only 3 centimeters long emerging, resembling adults in shape, complete with gills. The giant salamander is considered critically endangered, primarily because it lives in China, where everything is apparently a delicacy or is killed for some weird cure for erectile dysfunction.
The scientific genus name for giant salamander is Andreas. It's of course Greek, and it means in the image of man. And that, of course, is a reference to Dr. Schertzer's first error in describing the animal.
I am way out of my comfort zone. This isn't a monster I can catch on the end of a line. I've got to use my hands. Hanzaki, better known as the giant Japanese salamander, one of the largest salamanders in the world, and the creature that I believe is behind the Kappa legend. They get bigger than this, but wow, this creature is aggressive, even though we mean it no harm. The good thing is that these guys, unlike fish, are just as at home on land as they are in the water.
There's a Hanzaki noodled. And I'm very pleased, even with my gloves on, my hands stayed away from that mouth. He wasn't too amused by the fact that he was just pulled out of his hole like that. Looks a bit like a fish, but it's got hands. And that's exactly what this has got.
River monster. Giant salamanders like clear streams. And they also have a tendency to be nocturnal. So they're not often seen, and seen as though they're edible, that's a good thing. However, they are getting very close to being extinct.
Our guide Lisa told me about two giant salamanders that she knew of that were in pools near a lake. So I went down to see them, and sure enough there were. This one is fairly small. It's a little over a foot long, but at least you can see them. And that's something, because these things are nocturnal and they do tend to hide. This other one is a little bit bigger. But he's also in the shadow and a little bit difficult to see. I'd say he's about 3 feet or so. In addition to those two that my guide pointed out to me, I was aware of a giant salamander science museum in town, and I went down there to take a look at it. Now, it turns out it wasn't so much a science museum as it was a store. They were selling salamander products there, but they did have quite a bit of information about them. This is one of the first things that you run into. It's a little mechanical salamander, but it gives you an imitation of what they sound like. In addition, they had maybe half a dozen or so live salamanders in pools that you could see them pretty clearly. They had to keep it dark in order to keep the salamanders happy, because they like it in the dark. So for the most part, I'm trying to shoot not to bother them too much. That was the hand there that looked so much like a human hand. And this one is a little bit larger. Roughly the same size as the others, though, in a little pool. You can walk right up to him, no problem. But you can't touch him, of course. This next one is the largest one that I saw. He must be 4 or 5 feet, and he really doesn't like the light that I put on him. My guide Lisa told me an alternate explanation for why this was called an infant fish as well, and that story runs that there was a 70-year-old man that didn't have any children, and his wife was old too, and he ate some of the salamander and his hair turned dark, and he gave some to his wife and her hair turned dark, and they ended up having something like 6 children. So this is one of the reasons why salamanders are going extinct.
Now, a 10 or 12 foot giant salamander, or 15 or 16 foot like they had in ancient times, truly ancient times, back before dinosaurs, would be extremely impressive. As a matter of fact, one of the theories is that the Loch Ness Monster may actually be a giant salamander. Now, that makes a little bit of sense, because the giant salamander can breathe underwater, and you don't see the Loch Ness Monster very often. So chances are pretty good that if the animal actually exists, it doesn't have to come to the surface to breathe, or at least not very often.
That brings us to the most elusive creature in these mountains, the Yeren.
You can find all kinds of interesting things in a Chinese pharmacy. One time a few decades ago, someone found something labeled as dragon's teeth. They turned out not to actually be dragon's teeth. They were the teeth of a very large ape. This particular ape we now call Gigantopithecus. It was about 10, 12 feet tall, something like that. About 1,000 pounds, maybe. But the largest ape that was ever on the planet. It's closely related to orangutans, but it was so large that we don't think that it could possibly have climbed trees. It probably lived much more like the African gorillas do than orangutans do today. Orangutans are very arboreal. Gorillas very seldom go up in the trees, at least the large males seldom go up into the trees. Gigantopithecus was in this area of China. And the rumors are that it's the ancestor of Bigfoot, and that it's still here in South China under the name of Yeren. Yeren were said to have been seen in this area in fairly recent times. As a matter of fact, there was a very serious Chinese government operation to try to locate them about the time of the Great Leap Forward. Back around 1960 or so, a number of Chinese government officials said they saw one not far from here, and they launched a really big expedition to see if they could locate them.
Standing nearly 10 feet tall and weighing as much as 1,200 pounds, Gigantopithecus is the largest of ancestral primates. Could a descendant of Giganto survive to this day? Could wild man reports be evidence of descendants of Gigantopithecus still stalking the remote forests of China?
To me, the size of Yeren is comparable to Gigantopithecus.
Professor Zhou Gaojing is the retired head of anthropology and senior curator of the Beijing Natural History Museum.
We heard this report of a 4-foot-high creature that was yellow and brown walking in the bush.
On May 14, 1976, 6 officials from Shenzhen were driving along a highway near Shunche when they came across a strange creature covered in reddish fur. The sighting generated a great deal of public interest, so much so that the government began an investigation.
Because of this report, we organized a large-scale investigation.
Less than a year after the sighting, Professor Gao Xing helped lead a team of more than 100 scientists, soldiers, and photographers into the Shenongjia Nature Reserve. Located in central China, this wilderness is one of the largest and most remote in the world. It's also said to be home to the wild man.
During the research, we collected a lot of footprints, including this one. It does not belong to human or bears or any other animal we know. We have mainly two types of reports from the eyewitnesses. The creature was 4 feet or 6 to 7 feet tall. And then the color of the hair changed from bright red color to brown, black, even multicolored. With long arms, and they can stand up. In 1976, many officials saw the same creature at the same time.
In 1977, Professor Zhou Gaojing led the expedition in Shenongjia that yielded numerous footprints, hairs, and feces, presumed to be that of the wild man.
Given the report, we started an investigation, during which we found a footprint, but we are not sure if it's from the creature.
That expedition sent Gaojing on a 30-year quest to find additional evidence of the creature. Animals that roam the Shenongjia is the panda bear. It is unlikely witnesses would confuse it with the reportedly dark-haired Yeren.
This next animal is a little bit less hard to find, but you'd never find it out in the wild, actually. So I've gone to a breeding center in Chengdu to locate the giant panda. The giant panda got its name, according to our guide, because the person that discovered it in the mid-19th century was talking to a local and asking what it was, and the local said, very big, in his dialect, therefore panda. That sounds an awful lot like what the Australians said about the word kangaroo. The European asked the locals what the kangaroo was called, and they said kangaroo, which means, in their language, I don't understand you. Anyway, that doesn't seem to be true. That is, the panda was not named after very big. This is the symbol for the breeding center. It happens to be a gift from America. The giant panda was discovered and named after the little red panda was discovered and named. And the two are not related. The little red panda is a raccoon, and the giant panda is, in fact, a bear. The Chinese refer to it as a bear cat. The cat part of it may very well come from the shape of the pupils of the eye. They appear to be a little bit like a cat's eye. Pandas can't see very well. Presumably in the bamboo forest, the sense of smell is much more important, and pandas get most of their information that way. The little red panda appears to have been named by the Nepalese, and it refers to something odd about its paws. It's got an extra bony spur that operates very much like a thumb. And it happens that the panda, the giant panda, also has this same sort of bony spur. It allows them to manipulate things very much the way that primates do. And for the giant panda, it's very helpful in eating bamboo. Now here's a giant panda eating bamboo. And I want you to look at the paw carefully. And of course, you can see that he's manipulating the bamboo as if he were a primate. But he's got five clawed toes. And those five clawed toes are the regular toes of the giant panda. But there is a fifth digit, it looks like, or sixth digit, rather, that doesn't have a claw on it. That's the false thumb. These little pandas are having no difficulty at all eating bamboo.
An adult panda will eat 40 pounds or more of bamboo every day. And so the people at the breeding center have to go out and collect bamboo every day. And for each panda, they need to collect about 80 pounds of bamboo because pandas are particular about their bamboo. Oh, fight amongst the juveniles there. These are all very young pandas, and they haven't really sorted out who's in charge yet. That's a panda squeak. It sounds an awful lot like some kind of little toy. In any event, all that bamboo that the panda eats does eventually work its way through the system. And so the panda has to go at least 40 or maybe 80 times or more than 100 to the toilet every day. That's a lot of roughage to work through the system. The droppings themselves are not very well digested. Of course, you wouldn't expect that. After all, the pandas are basically carnivores, and their system is not set up to digest all that heavy vegetation. So they get very little nutrient out of the bamboo. One of the results of that is that panda bears do not hibernate. They can't build up the fat reserves necessary for that, and so you'll find them out in freezing weather. In fact, they kind of like it cold and wet, and so the fact that it's cold and wet today means the panda bears are happy. These pandas are about a year old, which means that they're still children, and that's why they're so active. The fact is, adults primarily munch down the bamboo, and they don't play around or move around a great deal. As a matter of fact, after they've had a good meal, they're likely to take a nap. Next, we're going to be visiting the nursery. Now, the nursery are very young panda bears, and the result of that is they have to be kept warm. This cold, damp weather is not for them. Their mother, under normal circumstances, would be holding them very close to her. But in the breeding center, they don't want to do that. And the reason is because once the mother bear no longer has contact with the little bear, she's likely to be able to start breeding again. These little pandas are very young indeed. They're only a few weeks old or a few months old. At this point, I've probably seen more individual giant pandas than the average person is likely to see in his lifetime. There's only a few hundred of them worldwide, and almost all of them are in China. The few that are outside are mostly in Japan and the United States. I don't believe that there are any outside of those three countries. But that's not the reason for me to be here. For a king's ransom, the Chinese will allow you to cuddle a panda bear between 6 months and a year old. This one happens to be pretty close to a year old, and he's very excited and very happy to be here. It's not really the people that have him so excited and happy to be here. The weather helps, of course, but you can see that bottle that the individual is tapping. Well, that's got honey in it. And this panda bear knows that when he's going to be brought into this situation and fondled by foreigners and Chinese that are well-heeled, that he's going to be fed apples and honey. Yes, every bear on the planet appears to like apples and honey.
It's all her fault.
That's what I said.
So what are the Chinese doing with all that money that they're collecting from these photo ops with the panda bears? Well, a few years ago, there was an earthquake, and one of the panda preserves was badly damaged in the earthquake, and the pandas had to be moved out and consolidated at another panda reserve. And this money is necessary for them to go back into the old preserve and rehabilitate that so that they can take the pandas back into their original location. At least, that's what they're telling us. As far as what you get for your money, basically you get a photograph of yourself cuddling a panda. And of course you get to actually touch the panda. But you'll notice that everyone has plastic gloves on and those smocks and everything. And of course that's the Chinese attempt to reduce any potential diseases being transmitted to the pandas. At about this point, I figure you're asking yourself the question, well, what does a panda really feel like? Are they soft and cuddly? And they are, of course, cuddly. They would have to be. Anything that looks like that's got to be cuddly. But the fur is not extremely soft. The little panda there is enjoying his honey. The fur feels a little bit like a kind of a scratchy polyester. Oh, a panda kiss there. They don't want the panda kissing her because, you know, they're worried about their panda getting sick. But I'm sure that she'll always remember the panda kissing her. There are about 1,600 giant pandas in the wild, and another 300 or maybe 400 in zoos and breeding centers like this one. Almost all of the giant pandas are in China. They live to be about 20 years old when they're in the wild, but they can reach about 30 years old when they're in zoos and somebody is taking care of them. There's a saying in China, if you've got a really good life, that you live a panda's life, because everybody is taking care of you and you really don't have to do anything. As a matter of fact, they tried releasing some of these pandas back into the wild, and these pandas have been so pampered they can't make it. In case you're interested in knowing how much cold a panda can take, you might find it interesting to know that the weather around Chengdu and up in the mountains nearby is essentially the same type of climate as what you would find in West Virginia. So the bears can live in fairly cold, snowy environments, and they don't hibernate, as I said before. Now, in the wild, panda mothers usually give birth to more than one offspring, usually two, but they can only raise one. Now, the breeding centers are actually able to take advantage of that by taking both of the babies away from the mother. Both of the offspring can be raised, and sometimes they have triplets. There was a very interesting article that appeared in August of this year about a giant panda. It was at this particular breeding center in Chengdu, and the giant panda was showing signs of pregnancy, and with a panda it's always difficult to tell whether they're actually pregnant or not, but she was reducing her appetite and mobility and things like that, and she had been pregnant before. So they were fairly sure that it was entirely possible she was again. But this appeared to have been a fake pregnancy, and one that the Chinese believed the panda was intentionally faking. You see, the mothers receive buns and fruits and more bamboo, and so they say some clever pandas have used this in the past to improve their quality of life. Apparently, being pregnant does improve the mother's quality of life quite a bit. Now, this guy is the last person in our group to have an opportunity to touch and cuddle the panda. There'll be other groups come by later. So, for as far as we're concerned, this is going to be the end of pandemonium.